Most of the time, when we expose our application to the internet, we want it to be secure. One way we can protect it is by encrypting all traffic between the client and the application itself. This would help prevent man-in-the-middle attacks, where an unauthorized entity can intercept every single packet that you send to the server. For example, if it's an e-commerce website, a hacker can steal your credit card number if you enter it in the online forum to pay for the goods. Also, if you enter the username and password for social media, this information can also be stolen. Now, when we encrypt the traffic, even if a hacker can still listen to all our communications between us and the application, they won't be able to decrypt the data, such as credit card information or a username and a password. To encrypt the traffic, we need to get a certificate from a well-known trusted certificate authority. And the best part, it's free if you use Let's Encrypt. The key part here is well-known, because you can generate your own certificate authority and issue yourself a certificate, but no one in the world would trust it. The trust is established by installing a root certificate from the CA, such as Let's Encrypt. Since most of the computers and mobile devices are shipped with pre-installed root certificates, you don't need to worry about that part. When a client first visits a website protected by TLS, the client and the server perform a TLS handshake. During the TLS handshake, they generate session keys, and those keys are used to encrypt and decrypt all communications after that. Now, to issue a certificate, first you need to generate a private key and certificate request. Then you would send the certificate request to a certificate authority, such as Let's Encrypt, to have it signed. And of course, you would put a domain name or multiple ones in the certificate request that you want to use, such as devopsbyexample.com. Next, the certificate authority would ask you to prove that you actually own that domain. You usually have three options. You can choose it to verify it using email, which is very hard to automate and it's not used in Kubernetes. Another more common options are HTTP-01 and DNS-01 challenges. First, let's talk about HTTP-01 challenge. This is a generic challenge that is not unique to Let's Encrypt. When you request a certificate, Let's Encrypt will give you a token which you need to expose on your website by following a specific pattern. Let's Encrypt would try to retrieve that token back from you multiple times, and if it succeeds, it will sign your certificate request and issue a certificate. Keep in mind, the certificate is public and everyone can have a copy of it, but you must keep your private key secure and not give it to anyone. Second, a common challenge is DNS-01. Let's Encrypt will give you the same token, but you will need to create a TXT DNS record to prove that you control your domain. When Let's Encrypt is able to query DNS and retrieve the token, they will issue a certificate. Later in the video, we'll discuss which challenge you should use in production and why. It's not only my preference, but it's based on real-world experience. And in the second part, we'll run two demos, and I'll show you how to use both challenges, which are applicable in all clouds, AWS, GCP, and Azure. To automate this process, there are a few clients that can help you depending on your use case. If you want to get certificates for Kubernetes, most of the time you would use a Cert-Manager. No matter which challenge you use, HTTP-01 or DNS-01, Cert-Manager internally follows the same process. When you create an ingress and specify the TLS section, Cert-Manager will create a certificate custom resource and generate a private key that will be stored in Kubernetes secret. Then Cert-Manager will create a certificate request custom resource. And in this case, the certificate request will be stored in the custom resource itself, since it's public. The certificate request will create an order, and finally, the order will create a challenge. The challenge can be either HTTP-01 or DNS-01 type. When the challenge is resolved, Cert-Manager will receive a public certificate and store it in the same Kubernetes secret with the the private key. The certificate will be valid for 90 days, and approximately every 60 days, Cert-Manager will automatically renew it by following the same process. When you register with Let's Encrypt, you use your email address, and if for some reason Cert-Manager fails to renew it, you'll get email warning. You can also use Prometheus and create an alert based on expiration date. Now, when you get the certificate, the encryption and decryption are performed at the ingress controller level, and all traffic inside the Kubernetes cluster will stay unencrypted. There are options to encrypt absolutely all traffic, but in most cases it's not necessary, and since encryption is a CPU-intensive task, it will require you to allocate more resources to your applications, and you may see increase in latency as well. Alright, let's go ahead and run the demo. The first HTTP-01 challenge is much easier to set up, and you'll see why soon. First of all, we need to create issuer or cluster issuer. I prefer cluster issuer because you can create it once and use it in all namespaces. Then you must specify your email address. If for some reason Cert-Manager fails to renew your cert, you'll get email message. Then we can use production environment, or if you have never used it before, you can try staging environment. By the way, I have a detailed tutorial on how to set everything up. Then it's very important for the issuer to properly set up ingress class name. It must match the same ingress class name that you used when you deployed Nginx ingress controller. Previously, we had to use additional ingress annotations to resolve this challenge, but newer versions of cert managers support the ingress class name property. Then we have a simple deployment object. Take a note of the HTTP variable that we will reference in the service. Next, we have a service and use that HTTP variable as the target port. It's optional, but I still prefer this approach. You can just drop the target port altogether. And for the ingress, we must specify the cluster issuer that we created earlier, the host that you want to use, and you must match the service name and the port number to make it work. And of course, we need to define TLS section if you want to secure it with TLS certificate. So I have Terraform code that you can use to create EKS cluster in AWS, but the Terraform code for Cert-Manager and Ingress Controller is generic and can be used in other clouds. You just need to use proper annotations to create layer 4 load balancers. In most clouds, it's the default, but in AWS, to get it instead of classic load balancer, you have to explicitly define it. You can find the source code in my public GitHub repo and the link in the description. Alright, let's go ahead and apply this first example. As soon as you create ingress with TLS section, Cert-Manager will immediately create a certificate custom resource placeholder. As you can see, initially it won't be ready. Now, Cert-Manager at the same time generates private key, and it will be stored in the native Kubernetes secret. That certificate custom resource will simply have a reference to that secret. Every Kubernetes secret is encoded in base 64. So if you want to get the private key for some reason, maybe to test something, you can get the value using the YAML output option. Then you can just use base 64 Linux utility and decode it. Keep in mind, base 64 is not encryption, it's just a common encoding technique. And this is actually the private key itself. Now, let me show you how to debug it if the certificate remains in non-ready state. Well, as with any other custom resource, you can describe it and get related events. This is the best place to start. If you have multiple certificates, you would add the name of the certificate, such as app-devops-by-example-com at the end of this command. Now, you can see that certificate request custom resource was created. And you can also notice the reference to the private key Kubernetes secret. Well, let's go ahead and describe that certificate request. In this case, you can actually find the certificate request itself as a part of the custom resource. Well, because it's public and you can safely share it with anyone. We can use the same approach if you want, and decode that request to the regular string from base 64. Alright, this is the certificate request. Now, let me describe that request one more time. and you can see the event that order was created. All right, let's go ahead and describe it as well. And finally, you can find that the challenge was created. Let's describe that challenge. Here you can actually find the reason why the certificate remains in the pending state. Well, obviously, we need to create a DNS record and point it to the load balancer. You don't need to specifically create something to resolve that challenge. This DNS is needed in either case just to route traffic to your application in Kubernetes. You can install additional add-on external DNS, which can automatically create DNS, but it's out of scope of this tutorial. Alright, let's go ahead and create a DNS record. In AWS, you need to create a CNAME or an alias if it's managed by Route 53. Before that, let me show you that Cert-Manager actually created additional ingress in Kubernetes to resolve the challenge. Also, it has a pod and a service. This pod simply returns the token that Let's Encrypt gave it to prove that you control your domain. When the challenge is resolved, all those additional objects, ingress, pod and service, will be deleted and only recreated in about 60 days to renew your certificate. Let's go ahead and create the CNAME DNS record to make our ingress work. In AWS, you would use load balancer hostname as a value. In GCP and Azure, you'll use IP address. And you would need to create a record instead. Now, let's wait until the challenge is resolved. In my case, it took a couple of minutes, but it's possible to take even a few hours. Just try to resolve your domain yourself to verify. If the certificate remains in non-ready state, just describe the challenge again and you'll see why. You can see that the temporary ingress was removed, as well as the service and the pod. Finally, let's check in the browser if you can access your application using HTTPS. Alright, it works, and you can get a certificate to check the issuer and expiration date. And the challenge will be removed as well. Let's clean up and delete the first example. To automate DNS-01 challenge, you need to integrate your Cert Manager with a cloud DNS provider. It works with AWS, GCP, Azure, and many others. You just need to provide credentials. In my case, I used OpenID Connect provider and created a dedicated IAM role to be used by the Cert Manager Kubernetes service account. It's all in my Terraform code. I already have a public hosted zone with a few records. For this issuer, you need to provide resolver. In this case, it's Route 53. You also need to specify the region, hosted zone ID, as well as hosted zone domain. Other than that, the remaining components stay the same. In Terraform, you can find how to configure it to resolve DNS-01 challenge. You need to provide the service account name and IAM role I ran. If you make a mistake, Cert Manager will complain that it does not have permissions to create DNS.txt records. And this is the role itself with necessary permissions to create Route 53 DNS record. You can improve it a little by limiting access to only a specific hosted zone. And also keep in mind that Cert Manager must be deployed in the Cert Manager namespace. Alright, let's go ahead and apply it. Now, we see the same certificate. And if we describe the challenge, you'll see the DNS-01 type instead of HTTP-01. In Route 53, you can find the TXT record that was created by Cert Manager to prove ownership. In a few minutes, you should get a certificate. Also, let's create a CNAME record for our ingress. You can automate this with external DNS component. let's make sure that DNS is ready. And from the browser, you can verify that the certificate is valid. Now, this approach to resolve DNS-01 challenge requires more configurations, but is preferred in production. For example, in case of disaster recovery, or if you simply migrate your applications from one Kubernetes cluster to another with HTTP-01 challenge, it would take a few minutes to obtain a certificate, which means your clients won't be able to connect to your application, and it will cause a downtime. With DNS-01, you can obtain a certificate before you start shifting traffic to the new location. You can start with HTTP-01. It's not a big deal. And when you need to migrate your app, just configure DNS Resolver. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.